Hello peeps and welcome back to Project Hospital. Welcome back to Campaign 3, where we've been taking deeper looks at what goes on inside the hospital. It's been very hectic, to tell you the truth. We covered wards and ward nurses and the nurses that move the stretchers to and fro. And while we were rejigging all those things and I was changing stuff on the wards and changing people's allowed roles and such, it caused absolute mayhem in the hospital. I think we're out of the worst of it. We had an awful lot of surgeries that were cancelled because there simply wasn't enough stretcher nurses to get them to their operating rooms, but of course I sorted that all out, as I said I would, between the last episode and this one. And we're just going to try our best to move forwards and have a look at surgery in detail today and the staff that make it work. I'll cover another sort of my version of a perfect room that I've put together, which I'll be using in my sandbox in future episodes. I hope that in all the chaos, I didn't waffle on too much during trying to talk about wards and nurses and whatnot. It was hectic. A clinic patient spent half the day in the hospital without being treated, and they're going to come back another day. That's fine. We're not looking at patients all that closely at the moment. We're not really running the hospital as such. We're just looking at different aspects. So we have covered nurses that look after the wards. We've covered nurses that transfer everybody around and their allowed roles and all this sort of stuff. But what makes surgery function? Well, you need 5 members of staff to make surgery work. That's 3 doctors and 2 nurses. So what surgery is this here that we've just... this surgery room belongs to general surgery. And that's that department over here. So, first of all, in your on-call room, you will need 2 surgery nurses. Now, it's currently daytime, so you can see here that we do have 2 nurses dedicated to surgery. So they're allowed roles. The only thing they're allowed to do is surgery. I do not want them spending time transferring patients, and I do not want them taking time out to look after patients that are on a ward. I want them to be available all the time for surgeries, and you can see how much one surgery has taken it out of them. You know, they need the toilet, they're very hungry, they need a break. So yes, you absolutely have to have 2 nurses that specialize in medical surgery. So if I wanted to employ one, all these desks are full, I can't show you. If we wanted to employ one, there must be... Can I demonstrate? No, maybe not. Okay. Well, if I wanted to employ one, you would have to select the appropriate this icon here. So if I would have to click that I want to employ her, and I would select surgery nurse to make sure that I do get a nurse that has this specialization. It would be extremely important, and then this allowed role means that they will do nothing but be available for surgeries. And you can see that they were indeed here for this surgery for Frank. So that's absolutely fantastic. We're not going to look at the surgery rooms in details. We're just looking at the staff for the time being that will work in it. Oh, look, a janitor has leveled up. That's fantastic. And look at all the XP they got from completing that surgery. So that's fantastic. And this just proves that you don't need the surgery nurses to have patient transfer. There's been a bit of question over that. You absolutely do not. They only need to have surgery switched on in order to get that job done. The other things that you need, so doctors you need in order for a surgery to work, is you need, if you want to find out just hover over the operating room here, and it says minimum staff required: one doctor who is a surgeon, one doctor who can assist, one anaesthetologist, and then it says one surgery nurse and one nurse. However, there has been an update recently, and it now is absolutely has to be two surgery nurses. I've always had two surgery nurses, so it doesn't matter which nurse is doing the surgery and which one's assisting. It's just there's two nurses available, and I know they can both work there. But now it's an absolute must. And I do a similar thing with my doctors. So you need one doctor that absolutely has this surgery skill. But I actually tend to get two, like I was used to with the nurse. So it doesn't matter which one assists and which one does the surgery. They can swap and change. But if you wanted this one to only assist, then they wouldn't need the surgery qualification to assist. So you can see here that I have doctors over here that operate only in diagnosis, but I could have them assist in surgery if I wanted to, but I do not. I've got two surgery doctors, and I've put them both on surgery and to assist. So it doesn't matter which role they do in the operating room, they are absolutely both available. And because they don't do any diagnosis, then they are always available, ready for surgery, like those two nurses. And along with them, you need an anaesthetologist. And here is Jane Martin. And you can see that all these, well, these two are now going to the workplace because all these members of staff were currently working on Frank, who's just had surgery. And she doesn't actually need the assist. Again, she doesn't need the assist at surgery. She is the anaesthetologist. She'll always be there. So I don't have to have that on, but I have, just because why not? Why hell no? It doesn't seem to get in the way of anything, but yeah. I don't have to have that on as long as she's doing this. So that means you can see here that I have 1, 2, 3 doctors required for the operating room, and then over here, oops, we have the two nurses. And you can see that on the same desk I have the nighttime equivalents as well. This means because the other allowed role, now we've been through the other allowed roles for nurses, but the other allowed role for a doctor, of course, is the diagnostics. Now the diagnostics means that they are the doctors that come to these diagnostic rooms, these diagnostic units. So patients that are on the ward when they need further testing, a nurse who has patient transfer switched on will come and collect them, take them to the diagnostic room, and then it's the diagnostic doctor that will come and deal with them and take them away, and then the transfer nurse takes them back to the ward. So you need doctors available for that, and I'm not going to want to mix them up for the simple reason that to have a whole team of nurses and doctors available all at the same time to do a surgery, you know, you really don't want, it just takes one of them to be busy with something else and that surgery won't take place, and then surgery can be missed. Likewise, if there isn't enough nurses to transfer patients around, the surgical team can be waiting for ages, and there's an allotted time, and then they can miss their surgery because no nurse ever takes them to the operating room to have their surgery. So, you know, you need everything to be working just so. So as a result, I tend to make sure that they only work on surgery and don't get involved in diagnostics. And likewise, with the nurses, I separate the patient care nurse, who actually now lives on the wards, so she's always there to deal with the patients that are on the ward. And I separate the stretcher nurses. And any of you who watched the last episode will note that I have now made a stretcher specific, I've designed a stretcher patient transfer nurse only nurses station. So when I come to do my perfect or not perfect hospital, but more my sandbox hospital, these are the rooms that I will use for them. Likewise, I have designed a room specifically for the surgical team. This is a new room that I have designed specifically for these groups of people. These is actually where the surgical doctors will sit. So you can see there's three desks, two for the surgical and one for the anaesthetologist. And these are actually nurses' desks. So these are my surgery nurses. And the way that I've made this work is I've made all this over here, nurses' station. I've made all of this the on-call room. So they're just housed in the same room. And then all around we've put the toilets, we've put vending machines, entertainment, we've put lots of plants around to make it nice, and we've got the coffee cup, so they don't necessarily have to go to the common room in order to satisfy their needs. It's all in the room with them, which is something that I'm very big on. You know, if the less I can have them move around, the better. And what's great about putting your entire surgical team in a room is when I come to do my sandbox hospital, I could place that room near the surgery rooms. Oh, there's another surgery going on. So the surgical team don't have to assemble from all over the place. They will all be right there, right by the operating room, so that they are good to go. Because what happens is a nurse will transport, I wish I could see who was lined up for surgery, but the nurse will bring the patient to the operating theatre via stretcher before the team will come together and actually perform the surgery. And if you want to bish bash bosh out those surgeries, then you know, you're definitely going to want to have them close by and available at all times. So that's what I really like about the surgery room that I have designed, is that it keeps the entire surgical team, both doctors and nurses, together, and they will be able to be by the surgeries. Not in this hospital though. We can't really change it up too much here, so you can see that I've just made it quite neat, and I've done this across all these departments. I've just made it neat so that we can see that these are our diagnostic doctors over on these desks, and these are our surgical doctors over on these desks, and then we've got a bunch of transport nurses transferring patients everywhere, and then we've got our surgical nurses here. But when I come to do my sandbox hospital, this is not how it works. This is not how it will work, because of course I've moved out my patient care to the actual wards, and that is a theme that's running through. Where are we? This is something that I have put all the way through these departments, and things seem to be running a lot smoother now that we've sorted out those roles. Let's go back to surgery, shall we? So what would be really great is if we could find a patient that is actually due for some surgery. They don't make that an easy thing. So let's see. What we will do is let's go to general surgery, hospitalized, and let's just have a look here to see. Right, so you're due a surgery, you've had yours, I don't think he needs any. Frank, they've all had them. So Richard Hall here is actually due to have an operation, and what we can note here is that these are the two surgery rooms that are set aside for general surgery, although the operating room is a shared room. So if you only had one operating theatre in your hospital, all these departments would happily use it. It's a shared room. So the team over at Orthopaedy will use the general surgery operating theatre if they don't have one of their own. The problem with that, of course, though, is that with lots of departments wanting to use one surgery operating theatre, you know, you're probably going to miss a lot of surgeries because there'll be a massive queue. But it is worth noting that it is a shared room. So if you are strapped for cash, you don't have to build more operating theatres just because you've opened up a new ward. So that's a new department. That's absolutely worth bearing in mind just in those moments. We don't need all these tests being done on Richard because we know what's wrong with him, and we don't... Oh, hang on a minute. Looking at that, though, Richard has a pulsating symptom. Now, oh, because he's got appendicitis. Chances are is that his operation will fix the problem here, but it may not. It may not. So what we what's happening here? So we need, who are we waiting for? So for Richard Hall to get his operation, we need these two available and these three available. And you can see we've got some on their way back to the workplace. Let's see how this goes. So let's follow Rich Hall here. I mean, to be honest, he could crash. I mean, he could legit crash. Do you know what? We'll put on abdominal palpitations, physical examination, and a fever. He does have a fever, so we'll take his temperature as well. Might as well just have a look. And what's nice about these tests is that they're all low on the discomfort. So we shouldn't upset anything that's happening here, because his comfort right now is as high as it's going to get. And he's also a pretty happy bunny. Look at that. He's had professional care. His needs have been reduced. He's comfortable. He's entertained. He's had a short wait. And it's a nice environment. So he's pretty happy as well. And when he's treated, he'll be even happier, of course. So he's going to his bed. Let's see. Transported to treatment. Okay. So they are now already, can you see, they are all assembling for Richard Hall. Now, you can see here that the doctors stay where they are. However, these nurses go there right away. So they're going to go straight to the operating theatre. Richard Hall is waiting for a transport nurse to come and take him, which will happen. The transfer nurses are, I've sorted them all out. So let's take a closer look at what goes on in the operating theatre. So here are two nurses come, and we'll just pause this minute. We can see here, they're still just sitting here. The doctors, they still just sit here. Back to these nurses. They come in, they're gonna wash their hands. Very important business. These scrubs shelves are very, very important as well, because they should come to these and get ready for the surgery. There we are. And in they go. So janitor hasn't been in yet to clean this up. We can see here, which I think can cause infection problems. So they are still getting ready. Now, let's have a look. They're still sitting there, not doing anything. Where is Richard? He's still in his bed. That's fine. So they look like they are doing some early prep work for the surgery. They're in the medicine cabinet and this warmer here. She looks to be ready now. So they seem to be about ready. And here comes Richard's transport. And you can see now the doctors have started to assemble. So now that the nurses have got there, they've prepped the scene, the doctors and the patient are now on their way to the operating theatre, which is absolutely fantastic. See them all? Look, Jane here is at the front of that train. So we can see here the nurses are ready. Here we go. So they'll come in and do the same thing. They'll wash their hands, they'll get changed into their scrubs, and go into the operating theatre. Yes, they will. Richard, as we know, is in the process of being transported. Well, it looks like we've got nurses coming down here to also begin a procedure down in this operating theatre. The operating rooms at the moment are pretty busy, because I'm sure many of you saw all the messages popping up in the last couple of episodes of all the things I was breaking, that they just, you know, couldn't have their operations because there was just nobody around to move the staff, to move the patients around. So there we go. This here is one of our patient transfer nurses. There he goes. He's off. And the doctors were washing their hands, so it seems that the patient needs to arrive first before they get changed into their scrubs. And here we go. They are now going to perform the operation, which is this one here. A minimally invasive surgical technique. The surgery is performed by cutting a series of small incisions through which surgical equipment is inserted. There we go, for his appendicitis. So pretty standard. This will be why he is on the regular ward, because it's a pretty everyday occurrence. Complications are unlikely. Although, let's not forget, we do have this problem here. Will the surgery fix it? Don't know, quite honestly, don't know. And there can be complications after surgeries in this game as well. I think the lower the qualifications of your staff, the higher the chances of complications after surgery, and also the cleanliness of the place. As we can see, there's still blood lying around from the last surgery that happened in here. So really, having a good janitor team on surgery is pretty important. It's pretty important. So there we are. It seems that he is now treated, and the doctors have removed their scrubs and are washing their hands and leaving. The nurses are finishing things up here, waking him up. They've removed his blankets and everything. And as you can see, they are now leaving. Now, I think one of them properly leaves and the other one returns and waits with him. So you can see here that they're washing their hands, because that's actually a doctor and a nurse, isn't it? So one nurse has stayed behind. Sarah here has stayed behind. And she tends to... Oh, I thought she would wait for him. Normally, they wait with the patient until somebody comes to transport them. And there he lies, just on his own in an operating room. Nice. But a transport nurse is on their way, I am fairly sure, to come and get him. Now we can see here, poor Richard. While he's had his treatment for his appendicitis, we do still have a problem here. He has an outstanding symptom that was there before his surgery, so I'm fairly confident we haven't created this problem. But this symptom will cause him to crash at some point, and we don't really want him to have to be rushed to the ICU and have a life-threatening situation. I mean, it's already life-threatening. Oh, look. Hello. Are you back? Excellent, thank you very much. Yes, this is life-threatening for Richard, whatever is going on here. So we definitely need to find this out. There is absolutely no doubt. So we're going to keep these examinations. And it looks like that David Johnson is not taking him back to his bed on the ward. He is taking him directly to his examinations, because this is outstanding and it's a problem. So somebody is waiting for him in a diagnostic room. As we covered earlier, I have diagnostic doctors in here. And one of them, there we go, David Lee, is actually waiting here for Richard to arrive. And there he is. So David Lee is now going to do abdominal palpitations on this patient here, and see if it reveals any of these symptoms. Right, it did, but not the one that we would like to see. It's a bit of a shame. So we're doing a physical examination, which I really don't think is going to help, and I'm honestly not sure that the temperature thing is going to help either. We could try an interview. What's this one? The discomfort on this one's quite low. We could do this protein thing that is indicative of inflammation, but I can't see this helping either. But as it's low, it's not going to cause him any real discomfort, then we can get this done. Yes. What's going on? Eh? What's going on? We need to find out what this is. So it looks like we are actually going to have to do lab work on this one. Does look like we're going to have to do lab work. So it looks like David is going to go for microbial sampling on this one. He's ordered that. We don't need this. So he's now going to be taken back. We haven't found what we were looking for. He's now going to be taken back. Where's all the sound gone? We've lost some of the sounds. He's going to be taken back now to his room. Now, we've been looking quite carefully at the ward situation over the last couple of episodes. Here we go. Back into bed with you. Good. Lovely. There we go. And now he's going to be transported back to the examination. I don't know why. For whatever reason, David Lee has decided to go and look at Christopher Miller. So they're messing Richard around a little bit. Is it this guy? Yes. So Mark Hall is now going to be doing the micro sampling. This guy over here. And because I blocked this hall off here for this ward, just so that it could be a bit bigger, there's now no simple way around to these rooms. I've really messed it up, but there we are. There we are. Just a mistake to not make when I'm building my own hospital. So let's get him in here. And I think we'll follow Richard's progression through, because it'll help us see other parts of the hospital as well. The problem for Richard is because he's in his operation and now he's been to two examinations in quick succession, he's not had the opportunity to go to the toilet or have his dinner from the patient care nurse. So he's getting a little bit annoyed, and also these are turning critical. So you can see here that he has a double debuff on his critical needs. He really needs the toilet, and this is starting to get on his nerves somewhat. But here he is, he's on his way, and the problem with lab work is, oh, actually this one is quite low on the discomfort scale. Well, that's fantastic. That's absolutely fantastic. And while we're here, we might as well look a little bit at the diagnostic doctors. And this is pretty much all the diagnostic doctors do. They work in these rooms and deal with looking at hospitalized patients and doing all their tests and diagnoses. They also write reports at their desks, and sometimes they will come and do patient rounds. I think they tend to do it at night. They'll come and just check on the patients in person, which is always nice. So keeping the diagnostic doctors near to the ward could be a good idea as well, but it's more important to keep them by the diagnostic rooms, I would say, because they quite rarely go directly to the ward. More often than not, they actually go to these diagnostic rooms. So he's come back to his desk. A clinic patient has been seen by a doctor. Has not been seen by a doctor in a very long time. Okay. Well, let's send them over to here. Nighttime. I suppose it is nighttime, isn't it? Can we do differential? I mean, apparently she has the skills to do it. I'd like to do differential. I don't know why that's not happening. Right, now. So we know that the cultivation thing has been done. Now, this is a thing. I'm assuming that somebody from the lab has to come to this room to collect the sample. So let's go to the labs. It's going to be this lab, I believe. This is microbiology right here. So I believe this will be the lab. Let's get rid of this lady. Oh no, it is daytime. Oh, okay. Maybe I should have done that thing for that lady. So let's see, where are you coming from? Not quite where I hoped. Ooh. Ooh, handling samples. So, I think Rachel has just come from the lab to collect Richard Hall's samples. Indeed. So this is what I liked about the old labs, is that I would have a lab, near the wards and the diagnostic units. Wow, there's something going on in X-ray, isn't there? There really, really is. Let's see if we can get a differential on that. Right. Yeah, so I used to have a lab by the wards and the diagnostic units, and I would have the lab assistants there only work on ward patients, and then I'd have a separate lab that would deal with clinic patients. But with the lab now being split into three different labs, it's just getting more and more complex. But the problem with it is that they do have to walk the entire way. So when we come to look at labs in more detail, that's something we're going to have to look at and make a decision on. So she is running tests, and you can see that it is indeed Richard Hall's tests that she is running, and her allowed roles are both clinic and hospitalized patients. So we could set one to work only on hospitalized patients, but they would spend all day walking to and from. That's something worth considering. So she's handling her samples. She's been running tests, but we are back to handling samples. Richard is back in bed. Mark is doing stuff with other patients. But yeah, the tests continue to see if we can find out what's wrong with him. They've been waiting a very long time. This is X-ray again. Okay, can you not do... See, I feel like she should... Oh, the differential diagnosis didn't work. Oh, right, okay. Sorry about that. Well, what can I do? Not much, really. Okay, processing results. Fantastic, Rachel. Fantastic. We've got more. Might have more running yet. She's running more tests here for Richard. So they run multiple tests for these samples. She's using a nice wide range of machines. What is this? Oh, okay. Yeah, let's not worry about that. Oh, she's now going home. Rip. Rip. So we only have one lady, Lisa, who works here in the evening. Now, there could be tests here from other patients. Uh-oh, a patient is collapsing. Well, that's no good. We can see here, look. It's no good at all. So, because we can see here that this patient has collapsed in the hospital, we'll probably go straight to... because they're not hospitalised. They've just collapsed here in the corridor, which means that they will be taken to the trauma centre, which is something that we were talking about in the last couple of episodes. They will go to the trauma centre, which is why it's good to keep those staff members free at all times, because it's an urgent situation she needs looking at right now. Come on then. So where is Lisa? Richard Hall is now collapsing. So this symptom that we're trying to find out what it is has now caused poor old Richard here to collapse. It's taken too long. Can we slow it down? It's taken too long for us to find out exactly what was going on here. So here comes Mark. Here comes Mark to help stabilize him. So they've now transferred him to the ICU. Poor Richard has had to be shipped off to the ICU. So what we'll be doing is we'll be waiting now for a nurse to come. Oh my goodness, they're all collapsing. She is now being taken to the trauma center as well. Look, she's hemorrhaging and all sorts. Oh my goodness. But we're more concerned here with Richard Hall. Here she comes. And that's, I think, again, our patient care nurse. I do find it weird that the patient care nurse does this transfer. I'm sure that they didn't used to, but she is certainly doing that. That definitely does seem to be occurring right now. Fine. That's because I've not been micromanaging that situation. And Richard is now on the ICU. Now, the ICU is pretty empty, so we should, yep, have doctors and nurses rushing to his aid straight away to undergo stabilization. Oh my goodness, why does it do this? Oh, bed required for treatment. Okay. Regular hospitalization. I'm thinking that it must be full, and we're not going to be dealing with it just now. So undergoing stabilization. So they've put him on IV antibiotics, which seems to have resolved whatever that symptom was. So antibiotics, so it must have been some sort of infection or illness, and it just so happens that his stabilization has indeed found, oh look, he was in septic shock. So his treatment for his septic shock has cured this dodgy symptom that we had here. So we don't actually need to worry about any more of these tests. Lisa Miller, who's handling samples down here, is very possibly handling and processing results. Richard Hall's, and they'll come in. But yeah, she is. She's working on Richard Hall's results right now. But we don't need them anymore. the situation has been resolved. But I wonder, out of interest, because the doctor did order these tests, would they have helped us find out what this was if they had come in sooner? So what's going on? She's filling needs. God, the tests take ages, don't they? She's fulfilling her needs, and she's walked a really long way to do that. Have you noticed? She's got a really long way to do that. Going back to workplace. Wow, look at that journey. That's mental. And now she's idle. Interesting. They yielded no results apparently. But you say that, but we now know what all the symptoms here are. She didn't take them anywhere, did she? That's rather bizarre. Fair enough. Okay. Well, there we are. Let's not worry about it, eh? Apparently, when it's in black like this, it means that it's finished and it didn't reveal anything. But he now doesn't have any hidden symptoms. I guess that's fine. So there we are, Richard Hall. Helped us just have a look through the surgical process. And we can see here, look, there's a janitor clearing up at the end of the day. Richard Hall will be fine, by the way, everyone. Richard Hall will be absolutely fine.
Thank you for watching. I hope you've enjoyed the episode. If you did, please hit that like button. As long as you are here, why not take your first step on the path to total coolness by supporting me via Patreon. The cooler you are, the harder I work, which means even more shizwa.